Good morning, church. I want to welcome each and every one of you to another live streaming of our service here at First United Methodist Church. We have some announcements to go through quickly. We're going to continue with our live streaming throughout the month of April. And also, we would love for you to hit like and comment, letting us know that you are watching our service this morning. Also, we have the ability to receive your tithe and your donation to the church if you would just mail it in, or if you could stop by the church office Monday through Thursday, 8 to 5. We'll be more than happy to receive your tithe or donation or offering. And if someone is not there when you do come to the church, you can slide it through the mail slot. And we would greatly appreciate that as well. At this time, let us start our worship with our Heavenly Father, Lord and Savior.
Good morning, everyone. During these times, it's been a challenge for me picking out hymns because there's like an elephant in the room, so to speak, even though the room looks so empty. And so I've been picking songs that kind of fall on my heart for the way things are right now with the coronavirus. And so I did happen to find to get a Palm Sunday song, and it's Hosanna. And I put the lyrics on my Facebook, but if later on, if you would like to YouTube it or something like that, it's a very good song to worship with. So here we go for our first song, it's Hosanna.
We're on our knees. We're
come to the time of prayer this morning, and a couple things we want to lift up in prayer this morning. We want to lift up the world. We're going through this pandemic of the coronavirus. It has affected everyone and pretty much every country on this globe. And the Bible tells us that for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son. God loves everybody in this world. And we definitely want to lift you up in prayer, those who are going through. Also, Judy Matter is going to be having surgery perhaps tomorrow, Monday. And we want to lift her up in prayer. She's been going through an ordeal. And she had surgery, and then she had a mishap, and her kidneys have become weak, and they're using this weekend to build her kidneys back up so that she can have surgery for Monday. So we want to keep Judy in our prayers as well. So let us go to our Heavenly Father this morning in prayer. Father God, we thank you for this wonderful morning you have given us to be in the house of the Lord. Palm Sunday, Christ's triumphant entry into Jerusalem. Heavenly Father, we ask for your blessing to be upon all who are listening and will listen, Lord, to this live streamcast. Heavenly Father, we thank you for being our God who has supplied our every need. And we invite your Holy Spirit this morning to lead us in worshiping you. Lord, there is something that has infected the world with this pandemic of the coronavirus. Lord, we pray for your wisdom, knowledge, and understanding to be imparted to those who can come up with a vaccine that will put an end to this pandemic. Lord, we pray that in your glory, Lord, that you will show us the way to do that. Heavenly Father, we're just so excited that even though there are things that may quarantine us where we cannot collectively come together and worship you, that we live in a time where we can still come together in our homes and worship you. Father God, we are grateful this morning that we live in a time like this because you're the God that supplies our every need and has made every way available for us to worship you this morning. We thank you for your blessings, for we have much to be grateful for. Not only have we awoke this morning to worship you, but Lord, we have the ability that through this pandemic that we can share Christ to those who don't know Christ as their Lord and Savior. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this great country that we live in. We pray for its leadership, our president, governor, and mayor, also those men and women who make decisions for us. We pray for our military, those who have served, those who are serving, because we have been blessed by their service. And Lord, we lift up Judy to you, who's going to perhaps have surgery tomorrow, that you will guide the hands of the surgeon, that you will give them wisdom, knowledge, and understanding as they are treating her, that healing will come to her body, and Lord, that rehab will be without any ordeals or setbacks, and that she will soon be able to get back to her normal daily activities. Heavenly Father, we lift up those who are suffering right now. Lord, those who are hungry because they've been out of work or have children home that may be hungry. Those who are wondering where they're going to get the money for rent, Lord, and pay other kinds of bills. You know the needs and concerns in the hearts of all the people. Lord, we ask that you will provide a way to meet those needs. We thank you for this church and its many facets of ministries. We pray for our children's ministry, our youth ministry, our adult ministries, that during this time, Lord, that we're taking advantage of the time to draw closer to you, to read more in your word, to pray more, and to think about how we can do random acts of kindness to encourage one another and be the witness of who we should be in you. We thank you for our pastor and his family. We pray for your blessing to be upon him, Lord, as he is going through this and wondering, Lord, how to best serve those who are in need. And Lord, we just pray that you will continue to use him, because we have been blessed as a church by his service. We pray, Heavenly Father, in gratitude and thankfulness for your word, for we know it's true. And if there are those here this morning who have not heard Jesus preach, Lord, we pray that you will prepare their heart for the sermon, for they are about to receive. Put in our hearts, Lord, a desire to chip away the old man so that we can understand the new life that comes when we surrender our hearts to Jesus Christ. So, Heavenly Father, we thank you for the truth that is to be preached in your word. For your word teaches us much. It teaches us to pray the prayer that we now pray together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. And don't forget, we don't have ushers that are passing out offering plates. So you have to take upon yourself to bring your tithe and offering and donation to the church. Thank you.
In Jerusalem that day, the soldiers tried to clear the narrow street, but the crowd pressed in to see the man condemned to die on Calvary. He was bleeding from a beating. There were stripes upon his back, and he wore this crown of thorns upon his head, and he bore with every step the scorn of those who cried out for his death. Down the Via Dolorosa, called the way of suffering, mas la gente se acercaba para ver a que llevaba aquella cruz. Una vía dolorosa, que es la vía del dolor, como vera vino Cristo Rey Señor. Y fue que quieren quiso ir por su amor. Made its way to the heart of Jerusalem.
our scripture this morning, Matthew 21, verses 1 through 11. As they approached Jerusalem and came to Bethphage on the Mount of Olives, Jesus sent two disciples, saying to them, "Go to the village ahead of you, and at once you will find a donkey tied there. Bring with her a colt by her. Untie them and bring them to me. If anyone asks anything to you, says anything to you, tell them that the Lord needs them, and he will send them right away." This took place to fulfill what was spoken by the prophet: "Say to the daughter of Zion, see, your king comes to you, gentle and riding on a donkey, on a colt, the foal of a donkey." The disciples went and did as Jesus had instructed them. They brought the donkey and the colt, placed their cloaks on them, and Jesus sat on them. A very large crowd spread their cloaks on the road, while others cut branches from the trees and spread them on the road. The crowds that went ahead of them, and those that fetched, and those that followed, shouted, "Hosanna to the Son of David. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest." When Jesus entered Jerusalem, the whole city was stirred and asked, "Who is this?" The crowds answered, "This is Jesus, the prophet from Nazareth in Galilee." May God add a blessing in hearing and reading of his holy word. It seems absolutely incongruous, unbelievable, that on a Palm Sunday I would stand before a camera and a very nearly empty congregation. Preaching about Jesus' triumphal entry at Jerusalem, one of the highlights of the Christian year. The children singing Hosanna and marching around with palm branches, the crosses that we wear so often upon our lapels, all absent this morning. Jesus said in one of the Gospels that if the crowds were silent, even the rocks would cry out. Today is the day when the rocks cry out. And yet, Jesus still rode into Jerusalem that day. He rode in Matthew's gospel upon both the colt and its foal. It's an awkward arrangement, not mentioned in the other Gospels. It may have been that rather than ride on an unbroken colt, that its mother was there with it and Jesus rode on both of them. It's not clear exactly how that worked. But what is clear is that Jesus arranged this party. It wasn't an accident that he showed up on this colt. He had clearly made arrangements with the people ahead of time, somewhere along the way. The disciples went and did as Jesus had commanded them. And this whole scene, this whole parade with people laying down their cloaks and cutting branches from the trees and laying them down in front of him, was not as spontaneous as we might wish or expect. Jesus staged this entry. He had come to Jerusalem several times across the years, but never had he come like this. A king riding humbly upon a donkey in its fold. It was a beautiful moment. But just a glimpse of time. It was the pinnacle of Jesus' ministry in many ways. Because after this, with the cleansing of the temple and his withdrawal from Jerusalem, back to the home, we believe, of Mary and Martha and Lazarus, Jesus was shrouded again in mystery. And he taught in the temple each day and withdrew, and taught in the temple and withdrew, till that last day. When he had supper with his disciples. And then the journey to Gethsemane. On Thursday evening at 7 o'clock, I'm going to go ahead and have a Monday-Thursday service. We'll broadcast it again on live. Seems as though in the absence of normality that we need to do as many things as normal as we can. And though it may be again to an empty congregation, we'll still have the opportunity to remember the night that Jesus gave himself for us. It's what this is all about, really. The triumphal entry into Jerusalem was the pebble that was dropped upon the pond that caused the Pharisees, the scribes, the Sanhedrin to come together and plot Jesus' death. They were determined to be rid of this man at all costs. They wanted to be rid of him. And yet, nearly 2,000 years later, he still is with us. Absolutely and positively with us in our homes, in our solitude. He is there. As surely as he walked the streets of Jerusalem so long ago. That is the hope we share, even in our absence from one another. He is with us. Though we met this, the trappings of Palm Sunday this year, we can still proclaim with the people so long ago, Hosanna, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Just say that with me. Hosanna Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. That is good news. That is good news that will ring in our hearts this day. Though we may be watching on a phone or a tablet or a computer, though we may have no one to hear us proclaim the words, they are true nevertheless. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. He came in order that we might have life, that we might have it abundantly. That seems a paradox at best right now. But we're not going to be in this isolation forever. We're going to gather again as a congregation. It'll probably be at one service by the time we're back together. It'll be May. We always have this big debate every year. Should we go to one service the week after Easter or not? This year it's not really mattering very much. We haven't had the debate this year. It's been all about when will we be able to get together again? When will we be able to gather and hug the necks of our dear friends and shake hands or fist bump or stand 6 feet apart, but to gather again, no matter how long. We're committed to being together. We're committed to being the church. So often we come together and we think that we're church when we're all together. But the reality is that we're a church wherever we are. Each and every one of us are the church of Jesus Christ. People often talk about whether or not they need to come to church or not. You know, I can be a Christian right in my own home. I don't need to come to church. Well, let me tell you, I need the fellowship that we have. And in its absence, I've been driven to my knees more, driven to the Word more. It's been a tough time, but we will make it through. Because of Jesus Christ, who abides with us. Whether it's the Jesus who rode upon the donkey and its colt, or whether it's the Jesus who wept tears of blood in Gethsemane, went to the cross for me and for you. He is with us. He whose resurrection we'll talk about next Sunday morning. The shadow of that day influence even this day, for we worship on Sunday because Christ is risen. May Christ be with you now and forevermore. Amen.
I posted on my Facebook page page, the song Cornerstone, which has the lyrics to My Hope Is Built. However, I'm going to go back to the hymn book. So if you had one of those accidentally taken home Methodist hymnals, it's hymn number 368. And the reason I changed my mind was because the other version doesn't have the chorus on Christ the Solid Rock I Stand, although the ground is sinking sand. I love that chorus, and so here we go. Sing along with me. My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' love and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly lean on Jesus' name. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand. Second verse. When darkness veils his lovely face, I rest on his unchanging grace. In every high and stormy gale, my anchor holds within the veil. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand. Last verse. When he shall come with trumpet sound, oh, may I then in him be found, dressed in his righteousness alone, faultless to stand before the throne. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand. All right, join with us in our benediction this morning.
May the love of God, Father, Son, Holy Spirit, bless, preserve, and keep us all now and forevermore.